Oh, hi! I didn't see you come in. Welcome to Alongside Night Review, Part 2.
In the first part of this review, I went into great detail just to show how dense the shittiness was of this movie. Now, I'm not going to be doing that for the remainder of the film, but we're going to be brushing over the first half of the film in part two, explaining some of the major problems with this movie. And yes, we'll still be keeping track of the Lulbert nudges. So the kids leave the school and happen upon a taxi ridden by a Jamaican.
Wagwan.
Vitor tires?
What you got for me, man?
Who then gives them Penn and Teller tickets. Yes, they're no longer the Moon is a Harsh Mistress tickets. They are now Penn and Teller tickets. And then he scans them into whatever this is for absolutely no reason, because we know that it's not a transfer of property because he takes the tickets after he gives them the ride. And it's not a method to make sure that it's not counterfeit because he even says,
you give me counterfeit, them gwan find you.
By the way, in this movie, there is a lot of that. They spend a lot of time showing these weird technologies that don't move the story in any way, shape, or form, and just is really just a cheesy effect. So anyways, the kids leave with the taxi driver and, oh my god, a FEMA cat!
Murderous! Putting chemicals in the water that turn the friggin' frogs gay! Serious crap!
So they get to the hotel and the taxi driver throws up what appears to be some sort of libertarian gang sign. I did not get the memo about this. Then they go past a group of reporters asking about their father's death. They make it inside and find out that their dad's still, they know that their dad is still alive. Then they are informed why they need to pack and leave the country. But if they already knew that their father wasn't dead, then why did they need to explain why they were leaving the country? Wouldn't that be part of the explanation of why he's faking his death? And why did he have this weird flashback at school? He tells him that in the morning, the FEMA director plans on arresting all of them and putting them into a FEMA camp. So they're planning on leaving the country now, and then now they're going to be using these fake names. And the fake name they're going to be using is Rosenbaum, which is Ayn Rand's real last name. Holy fucking shit. Kevin Sorbo comes in and tells the kids to leave and go to a bookstore and ask for a copy of his book where he can receive a package from Al. He evades FEMA police by just standing there. Just standing there, and then stops for a minute to watch Doompaw on his TV screen randomly placed along the city. Then he goes into the Francois Rebel bookstore. Do you see how distracting all of this is? He then meets J. Neil Schulman casually reading a book. I said casually. This is the guy, by the way, who we can blame for this travesty of a movie. More on him on part three. They go into the back of the store where he gives him a belt lined with gold and does a Jamaican accent almost as bad as the real Jamaican.
I didn't steal the gold, Mom, because it don't belong to me.
Neil runs back out to preach to some random customer about the gold standard. Dude. Get with the times.
Explains why the fiat money has that problem. If there was some backing, any sort of commodity, all in Rothbard. It's all in Rothbard. What do they teach in the schools these days?
Laissez-faire.
Subtle. Where he then shows his version of the gang sign that looks totally different than anybody else who does this. So what's the point of even having a gang sign if every single character does the gang sign differently? Isn't the whole point to show some sort of consistency, like a passcode? What's the point of even having a passcode if everybody has a different... He goes back home and finds everyone gone and cleverly escapes FEMA agents via a shitty green screen effect. And you know you escaped a building in Las Vegas when you see the Las Vegas signs. Trust me, I live in Vegas. I should know.
Oh, shit!
Bright light city go-
jazzed about secession. Texas did it already. Who's next?
Well, with thousands of liberty-loving individuals moving here for the Shire Society, it's pretty clear.
Neil shows up again and flags down a former Fox News contributor turned neon hooker with his gang sign to go after Elliot. She swears she's not a cop on the Fifth Amendment.
I swear by the Fifth Amendment.
By the way, you can always be sure a hooker is not an undercover cop if she swears on the Fifth Amendment. Remember this. So they go to her house and fuck. Oh god, not this again. How many are there? damn it. He fucking broke it. After he wrecks that shit, he heads back to the bookstore to find Neo, but is only greeted by the fake in Jamaican reading porn. Virgin vagina. Okay. He tells him to leave because there's a camera and goes back to reading the same book Neil was reading. I have a feeling this is a product placement. I don't know, but it seems like this is. So Elliot leaves the bookstore and notices that on the Ron Paul vision that there is a protest going on headed by Adam Kokesh, which his classmate Miss Danforth is attending. He arrives at the protest to find Miss Danforth screaming out his name that gets him noticed by a FEMA agent. You know, it's not like his Inspector Gadget jacket wasn't going to do that already. The FEMA agents go after him, but it was conveniently blocked by Neil's gang sign. He manages to make it out alive and tries to go to his friend's house, only to find out on his phone that Sheldon Cooper is in something called Atlas Doesn't Live Here Anymore. Okay, and then downloads a video of people making an anti-gold PSA where they were busted for having a real prop piece of gold in the PSA, and hilarity ensues. This clip is one of those moments where it actually gets good for a moment, but not intentionally.
Is this real gold?
I don't know.
It's not ours.
I'm talking to you. Here. Is this real gold?
Is there a prop master here?
No, prop master. Is this real gold?
I don't know.
I don't think so.
No, I'm sure it's actually wouldn't use a gold.
We're doing this
gold.
To warn people against using it.
It's not ours.
Good. I'm going to keep it for evidence.
His buddy Philip and his alarmed scooter show up, only to go inside his house, which is currently being torn up by a vicious dog. Oh, wait. Never mind. They go inside and gossip about how Miss Danforth was swayed by his video presentation and got a little wet in the pants over it. Yes. That video presentation. But because she hasn't gone full ANCAP yet, he's not even remotely interested in her, and that's the last time we ever hear from her or about her ever again through the entire film.
If she can't even see the difference between my dad's limited government approach and the cadre's all-out anarchism, then she's never gonna impress me.
Remember, kids, statists have VD. Yeah, you remember when I said she was the obvious love interest? You got Shabaland. So blah, 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 his friend's uncles and the revolutionary agorist cadre ships him off to Axillary, where he gets a fake name and finds out that their computer systems register via extra normal.
Laissez-faire, now lie. Welcome to Axillary. We hope your stay with us is pleasant and profitable.
So fake names, Goldman, plans with his buddies that they're going to use Elliot as their Trojan horse in a FEMA camp raid against Utopia or something. I don't know yet. And they decide they're going to use Lormer as his handler. This is all gibberish right now. And Goldman tells him to look around and to do some shopping where people are, quote unquote, playing video poker. Oh, those are professionals. Then he's whisked away by a shit green screen effect to see a movie about...
We are self-aware clouds made up of microscopic computerized foglets able to configure sensors and manipulate matter using a network of smart dust particles.
I don't know what that is. So then hot girl swimming something something, I can't tell because bad audio, and then they end up meeting at the There Ain't No Such Thing as a Free Lunch Cafe, where she tells him she was just watching an orgy. By the way, what is with all this fucking weird underage sex shit, Neil? Oh, and it turns out she's going to be the handler, Lornel. And from there they go to the ANCAP Agorist Mall of the Future. And I'll leave it here for now, but stay tuned for part 3 so that you can learn that in ANCAPistan, if those crazy libertarians get their way, you can buy nuclear arms and marijuana cigarettes in the very same mall. Worms.